And this week we're going to be in Luke chapter 17, picking up where Pastor Joe left off. And I just wanted to ask you a question. You sometimes get frustrated. You sometimes get frustrated that your hard work, the difficult things that you do, the excellence that you pour into your job or your family, your home, your work, does it go unnoticed? Do people just assume that everything is that way because it just happened? Or do they assume you're not really contributing or doing anything and you're just doing your best and it's just not being recognized? Sometimes that can be very, very frustrating. This morning, my passage is from Luke chapter 17. If you turn there, starting in verse 5, we're talking about dealing with servanthood. How do you approach servanthood? How do you view it? So let's pick up with chapter 17 and verse 5. And we'll find that as we go through this passage all the way to verse 10, that serve the Lord not for recognition, but from a heart of love. That should be your motivation, is to serve him from a heart of love, not desiring recognition. So in verse 5, it says, the apostles said to the Lord, increase our faith. Now, this is not a random statement. This is in response to what he had just said in the previous verse that Pastor Joe covered for us last week. He had said, if your brother sins against you seven times a day and turns to you seven times saying, I repent, you must forgive him. And so the response of the disciples was, increase our faith. I know I can forgive my brother once, maybe twice, but if he keeps doing it, then I'm just going to write him off. I'm just going to walk away. I'm not going to have anything to do with him in my life. It's hard. I mean, Lord, I hear that you're saying I should do this, and I want to try, but I have this suspicion that I'm going to fail right off the bat. I have a sense that it's just going to be too difficult. But I really want to trust you in this. But it's, and the fact that the word increase our faith is an idea that says that I already have a little faith. Could you add to it? Could you take what little I have and increase it? Can you build upon it? And remember, this word faith is translated in our Bibles three different ways. It can be translated belief. Lord, I believe that this is true. I believe this is the way I should act, but help me to believe it stronger. The other way of translating is not just faith, but trust. Lord, help me to trust that this is the right thing to do. Help me to trust that I can do this. That as frustrating and as crazy as this sounds, I know it's you're telling me, so I want to believe it and I want to do it. So Lord, increase my trust. The Lord has an interesting reaction to their cry of, Lord, increase our faith. He says, if you have faith like a grain of mustard seed. Now it's interesting, the way in the original language this is expressed, he's kind of saying, since you have faith as like a grain of mustard seed, you have a little faith. I get it. You want me to increase your faith, you want me to increase your trust, but I'm confident that you already have a little trust. In fact, he uses this picture of the mustard seed, the tiny little seed that might fit on the end of your fingertip. In one place, he called it the smallest of your seeds. It's just incredibly small seed. Previously, in Luke 9, he had talked about the mustard seed growing into this huge thing, the kingdom of God. Here he's saying, yeah, you've got mustard seed faith. You've got a little faith. But look, don't negate that. Don't ignore that you've got that. You've got, for example, if you didn't have trust, you couldn't have trusted him for salvation. You couldn't have trusted him to take care of your sins, to forgive you for your rebellion and the hardness of your heart. You couldn't have trusted him to forgive you, to come into your life, to be your Lord and Savior, to take you into heaven someday. You've got faith. It may be small, but you've got it. Hang on to that. He makes this powerful statement that if you have faith like a grain of mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey you. In Matthew 17, Jesus had compared this mustard seed faith to being able to move a mountain and say, go here or go there. Here he uses I think, since it's later in his ministry, I think he scaled it down. He said, rather than a mountain, what if you just could say to a tree? Now the mulberry tree or the sycamore fig tree, it was a sycamore tree that looked like a mulberry tree, but it did have figs like a sycamore tree. And I don't know any what that means, but I trust him. All right. But apparently the roots of this particular tree were deep. They really hung on to the earth. But Jesus is saying, with your little faith, you really could say to this tree, be uprooted and plant yourself somewhere else. Plant yourself in the heart of the sea. I'm so grateful that the Lord is patient with your faith and with my faith, that he looks at the faith that you have and he says, I can work with that. If you just depend on the trust that you have in me, you can do great things. Don't always look at your limitations. Don't always look what you can't do. Look what a little trust in me can move. He can move those deeply rooted problems in your own soul. Those habits, those sins that are just so hard to root out. He can banish them to the heart of the sea. He can take those deeply rooted problems between you and other people in your own family or at work or your neighborhood. And if you trust him, he can uproot those. He can move them away, far away. Trust him with the trust that you have, not always asking, Lord, if you make me a spiritual giant, I can do great things for you. Here Jesus is saying, you've already got faith. Start using it. Start trusting me and see what I will do. As I thought about this, as he says in Matthew 17, to move a mountain, that's kind of where my mind goes. There's a movie that Kathy and I saw a number of years ago. It was in the theaters called A Big Boy. And a lot of you may not have seen it. You can rent it on the various sources if you have DirecTV through the Dish Network or whatever. I think it's DirecTV, yeah. You can watch it, but it's well worth the watch. It's a Christian movie about a father who is serving in World War II, and he gets captured by the Japanese, and they despair of him being alive. They despair that that he's, in fact, they get news that, no, he didn't make it, he did die. But the big boy, the little boy has faith. And his older brother is so upset and so frustrated with him. He says, how can you have such faith? And he says, well, the Bible says if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you can move mountains. So I want to show you a clip of where that takes off from there.
Fine. Want to move a mountain? There's one. Go ahead. Move it. Move it! Move it for everyone!
You don't have to do it. He's just trying to humiliate you.
Hey!
Not now!
No!
Thank you.
course, we understand that it was an earthquake, right? That it wasn't a big thing. It was just a coincidence, right? But for the rest of the movie, they know him as Big Boy, the boy who could move mountains. So I encourage you to watch the movie and remember that your faith can uproot and move as God uses your trust in him. Jesus goes on to say, will any of you who has a servant plowing, or in verse 7, Luke 17:7, will any of you who has a servant plowing or keeping sheep say to him who has come in from the field, come at once and recline at table? So Jesus moves from trusting me to trusting me. We know that serving is hard, and Jesus uses a couple of the most difficult jobs that he could think of, probably. A servant plowing. Now, that wasn't a plow with a tractor, right? It was a plow either behind an ox or sometimes just manpower, just pushing that wooden plow through the ground. It was, or keeping sheep. Jesus had already used the parable of the lost sheep a couple of chapters ago. Sheep was very difficult, a very hard job to wrangle those in. He draws this picture of someone coming in from the field and the master saying, come at once, and you just sit down and eat. Well, that's a silly picture. No, we wouldn't expect that. Will he not rather say, prepare supper for me and dress properly and serve me while I eat and drink, and afterward you will eat and drink? That's kind of a silly picture. I mean, how often does your boss at work take care of you? Usually, one of the things that helped me in the work world was to think my job as an employee is to make my boss look good. My job is to accomplish the things that he needs to succeed in his job. I was never under the misimpression that my boss's job was to make me look good. My boss's job was to make me comfortable. But so often, this is how we treat Christianity. Jesus saved me to make me happy. Jesus saved me for my comfort. Sometimes it's expressed in churches, but certainly not New Covenant. But sometimes people go to church with the idea of, what are they doing to make me feel comfortable? Well, what are they doing to make this easy on me? Are they playing the music that I like? Is the temperature in here exactly what I want it to be? Is the chair comfortable? Am I in a good seat? Sometimes we fall into this consumerism in the American church. Yes, we want to get inside the building. We want to get back to where the air conditioning is. We're going to remove these distractions. I got to tell you, right now I'm preaching to an empty room. I'm looking in the camera, thinking of all you wonderful people out there, but it's much easier when you're in front of me. And now I'm thinking about my own comfort, aren't I? Huh. But Jesus is making the point, that's not how servanthood works. It's not about you. It's not about your comfort. It's about God's agenda. Jesus asked the question, does he thank that servant because he did what was commanded? That's kind of a silly thing to imagine a boss saying, you know, this was your job, and I'm so grateful that you just did your job. I'm so grateful you did the minimum requirement. That just relieves me so much. That's not how this works. And can you imagine God saying that to you, his servant? Man, I am so grateful you just did the minimum. I am so grateful that when I commanded you, you did exactly what you needed to do and nothing more. Man, that just relieves me so much. No, that's not what we want to hear from God. We want to hear, well done, a good and faithful servant. Actually, I mentioned Luke 9 previously. The Lord had actually said that when the Lord of the house returns and he finds his servant doing well, that Lord will serve. But that's not our goal in life, is have God serve you or to God serve me. Your goal and my goal are to be the best servants we can, advancing his kingdom for his purposes and his goal, reaching people that he cares about and loves, even though we may not love them yet. In fact, he tells us how to respond as servants. Here's the deal. Do you want to go with the easy and the comfortable, or do you want to go with what he has? So you also, when you've done all that you were commanded, say, we are unworthy servants. We have only done what was our duty. Well, what an attitude to have. This word unworthy there is sometimes translated unprofitable, and it has the idea of, we didn't really add anything to this. We did what you commanded us to do. And we know, Lord, that you worked through that to accomplish your goals. It wasn't us. It was you working through me. I didn't add anything to it. I was simply the channel for what you did. And notice that Jesus said, you also, when you have done all that you were commanded. How many of us can make that claim? That I've done every single thing that God commanded me to do. Every single hint that he gave me, I followed through 100%. Every huge task that was beyond my faith, I took on to the faith that I had and trusted him for the results every single time. Yeah. Our goal is to be that kind of a servant, to do and respond exactly when he calls and how he calls, and to go in his strength and for his glory. And at the end of that, there's no glory in that. You and I both have encountered people who seem to only want to do it if you pat them on the back, if you congratulate them. Now, granted, I'm a high I kind of a personality and a cheerleader. I love to say rah, rah, great job. And I really mean that. I love it when people do even the simple things. I'm really impressed when they tackle the hard things. It may not be hard for someone else, but it was hard for them. You know what I'm really impressed about? Those people who don't ask for plaudits, who don't ask for recognition. They just do it. And why do they do it? They do it because they love the Lord. God loved us first, and then we love him. He saves you, he rescues you for eternity, and then you serve him. It's not a big deal. We're just doing what we should have done. We're just doing what is our honor and our pleasure to do. I remember when we built the building, that was 20 years ago, it seems like it was only yesterday, but these groups would come from all across the country. They would pay their own way to travel. They would pay their own lodging where they were here, their own meals. They would invite us to eat with them. And a number of them left money when they left and said, here, you use this. You're going to need this extra money. They did all this work. And then we would say, thank you. And they would say, no. Thank you for letting us serve God in this way. Man, I hope that will always be our attitude. That God has given me the privilege of serving other people because he loves them and cares about them so much. And he loves me too. And he knows that this thrills my soul. This gives me joy unspeakable. And certainly we can't forget that Jesus himself came as the servant savior. He didn't come all impressive and all wonderful. He came as a servant. He came healing and touching and teaching. And certainly the last night of his life, he came serving by washing his disciples' feet. God humbled himself to do the lowest tasks. If this is our God, his unfathomable sacrificial love should cause us to surrender our lives to him. We do it out of love. We don't do it for reward or recognition. We do it because we love him. Let me ask you a few questions. Let's do a little checkup this with this deal or no deal. Let me ask you, first of all, how's your trust level? We've been through some very stressful times. I must confess that this quarantine is kind of stressful for me and Kathy. Now, we're people person. We like being around people. We don't get to do that. I tell you, Charlotte's going to feel smothered by the time we're done. But what's the stress in your life? How is your trust level with him? Is he still in charge? Is he still doing things in you and through you? Or are you on pause? I'll trust him when things get better. I'll trust him when things improve. How's your trust level? Secondly, what does the Lord want you to do, but you're not ready? I think all of us have that time and experiences in our lives where we feel God directing in a certain way. We feel him leading in a certain direction. We say, wow, can I do that? I don't know. I don't know if I'm ready. Is there something in your life that God is saying, yeah, you're ready? You can trust me in this. You can move. You can take that next step. But you're holding back. And you're saying, not yet. I really wrestled with calling this, but you're unwilling. That's kind of harsh. Maybe you're willing somewhere in here, but it hasn't translated into action yet. What does the Lord want you to do, but you're not ready, but you really want to be? You want to take that next step. And I certainly have to ask the question of where are you serving in the kingdom? Jesus made this assumption that you would be a servant. He said, this is what you should say when you have done all that was commanded you. We are unworthy servants. He didn't say if you received commands. He didn't say if you happen to get some instructions sometime. He says, I'm commanding you. I'm leading you. Where is your place of service in the kingdom? And I don't mean just in the church building. I must confess, this is great timing for the life of New Covenant Baptist Church, because we do want to get back in the building. If you look at the count of people online today, much less than we've had before. And when you look at when we're outside, I remember on Father's Day, some of the kids who were outside were just baking in the sun. And as Pastor Joe said, the rain's going to come at some point. We need servants. I just be right up front with you. And we're trying to, we only need about four people initially for each service, and then four people to clean. And it probably won't be that much, because all we're doing is cleaning off the surfaces people touch and so on. And we're trying to have just enough so that we can reschedule, so you won't have to do this every single week. So you can take vacations and so on. But we need servants who are willing to say, this will bless other people. This will encourage them and help them to grow closer to you, Lord. This will strengthen the body of Christ. And I'm a part of it, and I just want to do everything that I can. Yeah, I'm blatantly making that appeal. But I also want to say that it's broader than just serving in the church. It's a serving in the broader kingdom. There are many opportunities to look to your neighbors who are struggling, to get to know them, to think through, how has God gifted me? How is he leaning into me? What is he asking me to do? I need to find some place where I'm serving him.